everyone, and a warm welcome to this session. This session is called Tell Me Your Story. And this was originally planned that in addition to Koral Gupta, who's seated here on the dais, we were also supposed to have Mr. Suman Patra from Delhi. He's unfortunately taken ill and he's not here. I'll be filling in his place and I'll introduce myself later. Please allow me to introduce Koral Gupta first, Koral Dasgupta first. Koral Dasgupta is an author, columnist, academic and art pattern. She's the founder of storytelling platform www.tellmeyourstory.in. We will discuss this in greater detail later. Where people across professions, age and geographies are coming together to write short stories. Her columns spread over magazines and websites, explore art, culture, women's issues, parenting, books, etc. She teaches marketing and communications to postgraduate level. She is also an advisory member at the Central Board of Film Certification, Mumbai. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a round of applause to Koral Dasgupta. Welcome, Koral. My name is Kulpreet Yadav. I'm a Delhi-based author and also editor of a magazine, online magazine called Open Road Review. I'm here in the, I'm doing this job of anchoring in my capacity as a volunteer for PILF. I was here last year as well and I really love this festival.
Hi everyone. So, about the platform, Tell Me Your Story, as Kulpreet has just introduced, it is a storytelling platform which gets people from across the world and from across different strata of age or profession or qualification to write short stories. It's like either you imagine something which becomes a fiction, or you probably scoop out a little bit from your life, something that has the potential to become a story, and you give it to us, which we publish online, and that is how the story reaches out to a greater audience. So what we thought was, one of the stories which had a lot of reactions on our website, we will start with reading out one of those stories. Some people have loved it, some people have said that it's probably it needs to be written in a different way. What we are trying to reach through this workshop is that the treatment towards a story. We all have stories in our lives. Every life has a story. So it's completely dependent upon how you present the story or the treatment you give to that particular little thing, the characters, the climax, the events. The little thing that you do with that little particular thing in your life or someone else's life or maybe your imagination, and the treatment makes it a good story or a bad story. So let's just begin and find out. Kulpreet, would you like to begin reading it?
Yeah, shall we straight away read, or shall I tell them a little bit more about Tell Me Your Story? So I would like to probably elaborate what Koral Dasgupta has said. There are not many platforms where Indian writers can write their stories and submit. I was there in Salil's workshop just a little while ago, where he was saying that do not just post all your stories on your blog, because there is no editorial process. Technology has made our life simple, but technology has also made our life complicated. Even if it's a poorly written story, it is just you have the luxury of publishing it. Ideally, what you should do is send it to platforms like Tell Me a Story. What will happen is it will either be accepted or it is rejected. If it is rejected, doesn't matter, you can try it again. If it is accepted, it is validation of your storytelling skills. That means your story has been accepted and now it can be read by a larger number of people. They will give feedback, and with that feedback, as a storyteller, you will grow. We also had this wonderful session of Roald Dahl just prior to this. And all of us know what a fascinating short story writer and children's book writer he was. So short stories are life, you know, it's something very important, right? So on this platform, we had a conversation just a little while ago astonishingly good short stories are coming. And one of the stories that we are going to read now, it is in two parts, the story of a boy, which will probably bring tears to your eyes. So, probably after the reading is over, we will tell you what you need to do about that story and how you can participate and what we can do about this story, right?
Just one word to add to what Kulpreet said. See, Tell Me Your Story is a platform which ideally doesn't like to reject stories. What we rather do is we mentor. I mean, at times people do send us information, because even we at times when we write, we confuse the difference between a story and an information. So when something comes which is more on the information or report side, and isn't exactly by definition or by treatment qualifies to become a story, we have our editors in place who help the writer to, who actually mentor the writer and help them transform into a story, and then we publish it. Unless the story is very derogatory towards someone or some organization or somebody, we usually don't reject stories.
No, I think that's even better, because mentorship is another aspect for all us creative people which is almost non-existent. As a writer, and of course today is about Tell Me Your Story, but at also someone who's doing open road review, I have started my own personal informal mentorship program wherein people can send their work to me and I read. But this is excellent. If all the stories that are coming to Tell Me Your Story are getting accepted, and some are getting straight away accepted because they're so good, and some, because there is a promise, there are editors available to associate with the writer and lift it to the level, I think this is a great initiative, and kudos to you, Koral.
Thank you. So, do we start with the story?
Sure, please go ahead.
Okay. The story is called I Am 13. It is written by a Bangalore-based author called Kurian Sirak. Act 1. 6:59 flickers to 7 on a digital clock and buzzes a beeping alarm. A hand of little Nairuk, aged 13, finds the table, hits the clock, turning it off. He then pulls his hand back into his bed sheet and goes back to slumber. His mother tries to wake him up, gently shrugging his bedsheet cocoon body with one hand and carefully balancing a mug filled with milk with the other. After continuous efforts of shrugging Nairuk to wake up, his mom finally succeeds by pulling him right upright on his bed. Nairuk wipes his eyes as he drinks from his mug. His mother sets his hair with her hand. He smiles back at his mother. Nairuk goes to his bathroom, brushes his teeth, turns on the shower and jitters in cold while bathing. He puts on a shirt, wears a school tie and has his breakfast in hurry. He stands near the gate in front of his house where he waits for the school bus. Soon the bus arrives, opening its row right where he stands. Nairuk waves bye to his mom and boards the bus, carrying with him his lunchbox and a bag hanging from his shoulders. At school, Nairuk struggles to concentrate in his class. He is rather busy looking around for anything else that interests him. After school, he runs around the field playing football with a small group of friends. When his match comes to an end, he hurries towards the school bus, which takes him home. Nairuk's mother opens the door as he constantly presses the doorbell. Nairuk heads towards the television set, throwing away his bag and his lunchbox on the couch. He sits watching his favorite cartoon show on television. Later in the evening, mother forces him to do this to his homework. After studying, Nairuk eats dinner, goes to his room and crawls into his bed. His mother follows him and tucks him in his bedsheet. She kisses his forehead as his eyes slowly close. The day ends really fast. Nairuk falls into deep sleep, preparing for another day.
So this is this was part one of the short story, called as the Act One. A lucid day in Nairuk's life is what Koral has read. I will read the Act Two, which is called Nairuk's Real World. The next morning, Nairuk is woken up by a sound. No, not an alarm clock from his table, but the sound of a shutter door. Nehru immediately opens his eyes wide, this time waking up from his dream. He looks around to find his actual home. This, in reality, is a garage, surrounded by tools and machineries which are covered with dust and other unclean garage props. He rests for a while, sitting upright, grasping every moment of the dream he had, trying to collage a memory of a life he could never have. He feels a sting of burn, which he is accustomed to, as his back is slapped hard by the garage owner, ordering to begin work. He prepares himself quickly by washing his stained face and wearing a shirt greased like a lab coat. He hears a bus approaching and peeks from a broken window towards a house adjacent to the garage. A boy of his age, clad in school uniform, wearing a bag and holding a lunchbox, boards the bus. The boy's mother stands at the gate watching her son going to the school. As the bus leaves, she goes back into her house. Nehru goes back to work, wishing and wondering how life would have been different if he was that boy. Their lives seemed separated only by a few steps. Would you like to say something?
So, this is a story where in Act 1 and Act 2, the writer has actually given two different views of life. One is a dream, the other is the reality. And Act 2 actually comes as a shock to the reader, because that is where it is explored that this boy actually in Act 1 was just hallucinating things and dreaming of things that he would have loved to have but didn't have. Kulpreet, my question is, this is a story written by a 21-year-old boy who is a first-time author who debuted with my 10-year story. Now, every person is different, every person's thought process is different, they have different upbringing, different ways of communicating, and so probably every person's story is different from the other, even if the basic premises are more or less the same. So Kulpreet, if my question to you is, this is a 21-year-old boy written in some kind of innocence, maybe the story has its own flaws and its own goods, but still it's a story well taken by the readers. If you, you have been there, done that, written books, lived quite a stretch of your life, seen a lot of things, if you had to write this kind of a story, what would you have written? What would have been your take on the story?
I feel this is an incredibly strong story of which actually brings to light the condition of child labor in our country, which all of us know, whether we like it or not, is a real issue. I live in Delhi and my heart bleeds when I drive my car on the road, I just take a walk or something. I see so many of these flatbed carts, rediwalas. So they will be serving food to the poor people, the labor class. And there are quite a few of them in any city in India. And nobody cares to see who is washing utensils behind these thelewalas. It's always children who are under 15 years old. Right? What is happening, the brilliance of this story, who probably has someone who's written the story for the first time, through the story, he is himself getting aware to this problem, and he's also bringing this problem in his own unique narrative and with his unique flavor for the readers to understand. What we're going to do here is, I can go on and on, I've written some short stories on a similar theme, but this is not about me, this is about you people. Because the platform is tell me your story. If you were asked to write a story on a similar theme, something that has really, really moved you at some point, the reality mixed with some little bit of fiction, how would you like to write a story like this? Any volunteers do we have? Okay, so we'll warm up to the part of being volunteer maybe in a little while, and let me answer the second part of Koral's question. I wrote a short story on a similar theme, and I approached this theme of child labor from a completely different way. And it happened to me while on a visit to Mumbai. I was really frustrated with something, small aspect of my life, and I was seated on a beach drinking beer. And I saw one 15-year-old peanut seller. Right? He comes to me and he says, "Sab, peanut chahiye." I said, "No, get lost. I don't want to talk to you. I've got no problems." So after a while, he comes back again and, "Sab, sandwich chahiye." I said, "How do you know I've not eaten food?" So he said, "Aapke jisse bahut log aate hain ya baithte hain, beer peete hain aur chale jaate hain, I know what goes on in their head." So he gives me a sandwich, and while I'm eating the sandwich, I pay him. I put my beer can down and he looks at it greedily and says, "Sab, main thoda bach gaya, usko pee lo." So I said, no, you are a kid. But anyway, he snatches that and he drinks it and he goes away. I have seen and experienced this part only this much. And this had stayed with me for a long time. You know, this boy, and who is he? Why is he selling peanuts and sandwiches on a beach? What kind of home does he have? Is there anybody in the world who loves him? What is he thinking about tomorrow? What is he thinking about people like us? And he's just like flesh and blood, like any one of us. So then I add the fiction element to the whole thing. And then I extend the story and I write this story. The story is called "Not the Only Peanut Seller Who Hasn't Heard of Osama Bin Laden." And in this fiction part of the story, I'm reading a newspaper, and the headline of the newspaper is "Osama Dead." Because I'm talking about 2013, probably died in 2013, when the Americans came to that area outside Pakistan and killed him. So I ask him, "Do you know who's Osama Bin Laden? You seem to be a very wise guy. You know what I want. You know what people come with, what kind of thought process. Have you heard of Osama Bin Laden?" He said, "I have absolutely no idea who is he." I said, "He's a terrorist. I was at my home. Whichever channel I was watching, they were only talking about Osama Bin Laden. And you don't even know who he is." He said, "Sahab, what is a terrorist?" So I now explored what is the terrorist part. So I explained to him, terrorist does this, terrorist, they have got arms, they go and kill people. So he said, "Wait a minute, sahab, I've understood. The police." I said, no, police is different. Police is different. Terrorists are different. I explained to him again, uniform, shiny metals, polished shoes. He said, okay, I've understood now, the army. I said, no, anyway, I give up and I come back home. Now, I'm telling you the fiction part, and I'm a guy who's been very successful, very happy, I've had a fantastic life, and I'm just drinking whiskey, and small little problem in my life I'm just thinking about that and cursing everybody and everyone around me for treating me the way they do. And next day morning when I wake up with a bad hangover, I pick up the newspaper and there is a photograph of a boy on which it is written, "Terrorist killed." And it is a picture of that boy. The boy who did not know what is the meaning of the word terrorist. And the story ends there. So this is how, I hope I've been able to, I'm recalling a 2013 story. So the problem of child labor, the real problem with my own imagination and fiction element, adding all that, I bring it out in the form of a story, send it to a magazine in United Kingdom, it gets accepted as one of the best short stories written in 2013, and it gets circulated really well. Probably we might have a short film on that. So this is the power of a story. So if you have a theme or something that moves you, here is a platform where you can send, and it is guaranteed, unless it is really, really bad or derogatory or something like that, 99.9% it is going to be accepted by this wonderful platform, it will be published, and your own writing skills and imagination skills are going to improve. Right?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for this brilliant story. I will actually still lost into it.
Actually, your story works so well because it's not just about child labor.
Can someone give the applause? Yeah. We want everyone to participate, please. This is excellent.
Thank you. Kuldeep, I think your story is wonderful. I am also still kind of shaken by how it ended. And your story, it became such a wonderful story because it went beyond just child labor. And it reflected more on the society itself and what the police are doing, what we are doing to our children. And that's why it had, it became multi-layered and a reflection on our society, and that's what a good story should do. So it simply sent a shiver down my spine, just your say, narrating it. That was beautiful.
Thank you. We're going to share this mic, so this mic can float around and anybody wants to say something or comment something, or if you have had a... but you know, madam, I would like to just briefly react to what you've said. Please understand, you might think, some of you, that main story nahi likh sakta ya nahi likh sakti. It is not true. I did a workshop yesterday in which I was trying to explain that the beauty about nature is that all of us are unique and superbly creative people. We just have to convince ourselves that I can do this job. And trust me, that is the first starting point. There is the first stage. Second and the final stage is, when you start doing it, you will be able to do it. Because at the end of the day, it is work, right? So reality, fiction, everything can be combined to make a beautiful product.
And you know what? A lot of people are writing for the first time. Actually, that is my vision. Every new author is my achievement. That's how I see it. Small stories, 200 words to 1500 words. But then, 9 years old are writing stories, and they're beautiful stories. Trust me, their imagination is much better than ours. They're innocent. So, most of these people are first-time authors who suddenly have got a platform. They may not have the patience or content to write a full-fledged book, but then stories to her life may open. So a lot of people say that before we opened the Word file of our computer to sit down and write, because you wanted us to, we didn't know we had so much to tell about it. I mean, that's I think the best way to compliment us. I felt so beautiful about it. Ma'am, you had to say something.
Yes. Is this an online portal where we'll be sending the stories?
Yes.
And what about stories that have already appeared on Facebook or blogs?
It's not a blog site.
No, can we send those?
See, we are not taking anything which is previously published or which will be published later elsewhere. We are building up a boutique platform. And what we aim is, once we have our collection in place, which we already have, and we are just going on embellishing it with every given day. If you look at the website, you will understand why I am claiming this. We don't encourage or we don't accept any story which has already appeared somewhere before. We claim this exclusivity because we are trying to sell these stories to somewhere, some other place, and get money back to our authors. Because we really believe that every person who has showed some kind of talent, if she deserves, she must go back with something. Which, I mean, today authors are not, I mean, we face a lot of flaks.
So you're paying the authors?
Not yet, because I haven't got paid myself. The day I get paid, even a penny, a share will go for them.
Thank you.
Any other comments or questions?
Yeah, I just wanted to
ask,
can we hear some stories, please?
Have you written something, anyone who's carrying a piece of flash fiction or some short story?
Yeah, even if you haven't written, you know, stories keep popping up every time. Something must have happened to you this morning. Tell that to us.
The power of story is, I was in Bangalore Literature Festival last year, and I was seated in a panel and we were discussing short stories, and there was one Kannada writer who mentioned about a 7 or 8 word short story that he had heard somewhere in Europe, and he found it so fascinating, and when he read it, when he spoke that story in front of the audience, that story has got into my system. And when I tell it to you, it will go into your system, guaranteed.
Exactly.
That is the power of story. That is the narcotic power of the story. So the story is, when he woke up, the dinosaur was still there. Think about it. When he woke up, the dinosaur was still there. There are many meanings to this. What I understand is, nothing has changed. Right? So, nothing actually changes, ever. So, when he woke up, the dinosaur was still there. I'll just briefly, can I touch upon the different forms of stories? So, what is an ideal, you might have certain questions about short stories. What is the ideal length of a short story? The ideal length of a short story is 1,000 to 8,000 or 12,000 words. Right? Anything that you write less than 1000 words is called what? Anybody can tell me? Yes, please. Absolutely. So anything that is less than 1000 words is called flash fiction, and a story which is less than 500 words is called what? Superb. Flash fiction. This is outstanding. I rarely get such answers. Honestly, you guys, you people are very well, you are aware and you've been doing your homework. Then you. Oh, you were there yesterday. Oh, okay. Okay. Anyway, that means I am not a bad teacher. Okay. So you also have 100 word short story. You also have 550 word short story, and then you have 6 word short story. The beauty is, and today there are platforms existing. The beauty is, if you've written something very fascinating which has moved you, you can send it to the platforms, and it can be done in one evening. You're not writing a novel. You're just writing a short story. You're writing something that you've seen and it has moved you. It could be just in the same form, or if you want, you can just dovetail a little bit of fiction element to it, make it, you know, lift it up a little bit, and then present it. Yes, please.
There are terribly tiny tales, right? So I've written one of them. Can I just...
Sure. It's all with pleasure. That's the purpose.
The crackling of the opening newspaper was her cue to wake up for school every morning. The day it stopped, she stopped going.
Oh, wow. That's good. So I think it's a powerful story, and that's why there was 2 second pause, you know, and I just didn't know what to say because it takes that much time to sink in. That's the power of words. Please sit down. That's the power of 10, 12 words, you know. You can have such a powerful message.
I really appreciate the thing that, I mean, you have been able to put forward your story in 2 sentences, which I cannot. My tendency is to go on elaborating. Everybody's tendency is to go on elaborating. Because we are very proud of ourselves. We feel whatever we write are, I mean, those are, you know, the masterpieces of the world. It takes a lot of gray matter in the top portion of our bodies to be able to frame ourselves in 1 sentence, 2 sentence, and those 6 word stories. So, I don't know what to say. Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying, that they're doing it well.
Let's do 6 word story game. Okay, let me start. I'm doing it right now, extempo. I came to Pune. One 6 word short story. I came to Pune to attend festival, and that changed my life. It could be any one of you. And this is more than 6 words, but anyway. So anybody who can do 6 word, 10 word, fine. Let's not have a restriction. Yes, please. You have the mic there. Someone has got the mic, please.
I recently won a competition with this story of Indian film project at 8 word story. The story goes like, the sun went somewhere and the clock became a myth.
The sun
went somewhere and the clock became a myth.
Wow. Anyone else? Or while listening to us also, you can write this thing over there.
It goes like this. I saw you and the prop was lost.
Fantastic. A big round of applause to these three. There's one more volunteer there. Can you give the mic to her?
Please.
Over there. Thank you.
This is something which I sent to Terribly Tiny Tales a long time back, but it didn't get selected, you know. So I wrote, and the worst part was the silence at the other end, not knowing if it was a network problem or the end of a beautiful time.
Wow.
Beautiful. With anyone else? You know, this morning I received a story. Okay, she's coming.
This is not something I've written, but it's something I've read and I thought it was really beautiful. It said, the smallest coffins are the heaviest.
Yeah, I think it's a proverb as well.
Yeah, I think it's a proverb of similar type.
Yeah, very good. You know, this morning I received a story which, it's not yet published, but just one line in that story resonated so much in my brain. It says about a dying man and a doctor who is trying to cure that dying man. and the man tells the doctor. The doctor says that please cooperate. And the dying man says, I need to live, not necessarily extend my life. I need to live from either side of time. Written by a first time author. Again, 18-year-old. So, yeah, I mean, ma'am, did you want to say something? I actually made missed out.
Yeah, yeah, the mic can come here, please.
Actually, I wrote this for the iCoop class that day.
That can work.
And I feel it can make a story in itself. Love withered as the family bloomed.
Love
withered as the family bloomed.
It's beautiful. Yes, please. Can the mic please pass up?
There's something I wrote playing on the colors of black and white. It's a little dark. Pitch black, so our son would not see. White lies, all that he promised me.
Fantastic. Do you like poems?
Yes.
Oh, we would love to receive your poems.
Okay. May I know where I can send it to?
Just go to www.tellmeyourstory.in.
Okay.
But do read the terms and conditions before you send.
Yes. Thank you.
Someone else? Yeah, we did
English.
Everything in
English.
200 to 1500 words is our idea then. But if it extends 1500 by a little bit, we don't know.
It's all mentioned there in the website.
Yeah, everything is there in the
Anybody else?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. I'm a teacher, so I had just written this one day out of the blue. Frog in my throat, how I croak, students laugh, I cry.
Wow.
Oh! I am a teacher as well, so I know where you come from.
Brand new pair of baby's shoes for sale.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Beautiful.
Who else?
I think I've heard that.
Yeah, it's wrong.
Okay.
It's not yours. Yeah, yeah.
It's my friends.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Who else?
The fire burned brightly, giving light to all, but only she collected the ashes in the end.
Whoa.
This is so beautiful. Do you guys tweet about these?
I'm not on any social media.
Okay. Yeah, you guys are too young to tweet about
it. We can have a one-hour discussion whether to be on social media or not.
I know.
And I'm going to be speaking.
No, don't corrupt them. They are too young. Let them be.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, would you like to know a little bit, how many of you attended my workshop yesterday? Oh, quite a few of you. We were talking about the comparisons between short stories and novel, and some of you might be toying with the idea of, you know, writing a novel at some stage in your life, and you might be thinking that, oh my god, this is such a lot of work and I have to invest so much of time and energy. It's actually not so. You know, if you're a person who's been observing life, writing short stories, writing 6-word stories, keeping it preserved in your diaries, you automatically will come to a stage where you write 200 words, 2000 words, 3000 words. And one day, did I explain about how I started writing? No? Okay, I can do that now.
Can we just ask them how many of you write? I mean, if you are in a lit fest, I assume that you are interested in literature.
Yeah.
So,
how many aspiring writers?
Yeah, quite a few. And how many of you actually wrote something and felt very shy to share it or something like that? Honestly, anybody? One hand is coming up. Okay, good. Please take it.
Yeah. So I briefly explained about my background. That I graduated from Nauroji Wadia College in Pune. Because though I hail from the state of Haryana, so that way I'm very attached to this town because I did my graduation here. And then I went to the Naval Officers Academy. I became an officer. I started floating around here and there. 20 years. I did a lot, but I read some books, but not that much. And one day, I found myself, of all the places, and I find this so fascinating, everybody loves the story, and the true story of my life, how I became a writer. And probably, in some ways, it can resonate with you, and you people might be closer to that stage. So I was at Howrah Railway Station, which is 3 hours from Haldia, and the train was 10 hours late. I was going to Patna for some official work.
I didn't know Calcutta and Patna are not connected by Air India. They still probably aren't. I don't know why Bihar and West Bengal are so unfriendly with each other. Which, whatever be the case, I couldn't fly, so I was going by train.
I'm a Bihari and I'm a Bengali. How dare you say that?
Okay, so I had a notebook. I had absolutely no clue. I was writing short stories and some six-word stories once in a while like that, maybe in a bar or after a run in the morning or something. And I had this diary and I started writing suddenly at Howrah railway station. I wrote 10,000 words in about 8 to 10 hours. And I went back to the place, and when I returned, I read those pages and I thought that makes a great story. And I shared it with my wife first, and I was very, very hesitant to share, as some of you are, which is natural. She went inside the bedroom and who has written, I mean, first she said, who's written this? Because I had been married for 12 or 15 years at that time, and who has written this? I said, this is written by me. And she's like, you know, I don't know my husband that well. I said, no, I've written for the first time. So she went inside, she reads a lot of books. At that point, she was reading more books than me. She came out and said, this is really good. And that gave me a lot of confidence. I shared it with some more friends. It gave me more confidence. And then I Googled the publishers, and I think probably that part of the story I might have told you. So then the publishers accepted it, and the book came out. And that is how the journey started. And I realized with my first book, a lot of faults. But it happened because of the passion that I had developed, which will happen with you also if you develop that kind of passion, since you're aspiring writers. First book will come out, there will be lessons to be learned, we'll move on to the second book, we'll move on to the third book. We just discussed Roald Dahl, how he started his career. He started his career in World War II as a fighter pilot. And he was absolutely nowhere close to writing stories at that point. But he ended up becoming world's, I mean, 21st century's most recognized short story writer. So, thought I'll share these thoughts with you.
When you say about this, now, what comes to my mind is, do you know Hitler wanted to be an artist?
Yeah,
he wanted to be a painter and an architect. Architect was something that was suggested to him. He didn't want to take that. He wanted to be a painter. His love was colors. When that he
should have been granted.
Three times he was not allowed to the art college, and that is when he said, "If I am not allowed, I'll reach there in some way or the other."
And then he owned
it. And yeah, I mean, he needed to feed himself. He kept on not eating anything because his pocket was zero. He kept on not eating, but till how long do you survive? Somewhere at that point of time, a lot of war things were happening. He had to get some food. For food, the easiest way to get food was to go to the military and say that I volunteered. So he got there, volunteered, and he created art with blood. That's the saddest thing that you could have heard, Prarati. Anyway, for those who felt shy about sharing your stories, let me tell you a little bit thing from my life, which is the most embarrassing thing to happen, but then still, I mean, I don't care about the embarrassment. My first book was an academic biography of Shah Rukh Khan. It's called Power of a Common Man. So I was under the impression that I have written about Shah Rukh Khan means I'll not have to do any kind of effort about it. It'll just sit like hotcakes. That, of course, was shattered once the book hit the market. Nobody knew and nobody cared. Publishers back you only when you back the publishers. So, after some time, I had to really buck up and do something about it. So, the first thing that I thought of doing was, I wanted to reach out to social media, all the fan pages. And I told them that this is a book which I want to talk about. Now, fan page owners and fan page runners in social media, all of them thought that they were also Shah Rukh Khan. So, to every query that I forwarded, the responses came as, sure, darling. Of course, sweetheart. So, I kind of ducked that down and kept the conversation alive. They said that we'll share the thing on our page and we will punch it up. Which also did not happen to that effect. So, one particular case I remember where I had gone to a fan page and posted the photograph of my book. Those were initial days when I didn't know anything about book marketing. So, I just had posted that. For the entire day, I thought that likes will just come flowing in, which didn't happen. And that entire day went by and nobody even cared to look. And if you know about this Facebook page thing, probably you know that when an external body posts a message, it goes somewhere in the back burner. You don't see it right in front of the page.
So nobody saw it. And next morning when I woke up, I saw that there was one notification, someone had commented on that particular post. So I was overjoyed ki chalo kisi ko to fark pada. I quickly opened my laptop, went to that page and saw that the guy who had commented had written life insurance, home insurance, car insurance. So one insurance guy had come there aur lage haath Shahrukh Khan ke saath apna insurance bechne ki koshish kar raha. So I think if I, after writing one book, that about Shahrukh Khan, 400 crore ka aadmi, jisko main 400 rupaye mein bechne ki koshish kar rahi thi, can be reduced to that level. Nobody needs to feel shy. Your story, sabko matlab apne stories ka apna haq hai. Please go ahead and push it forward wherever you want to.
No, if you're an artist, you have to be thick-skinned. Trust me. You know, when I wrote my first book, so my sister-in-law read that book, The Pet, the one I wrote at Havra Station, and then I completed later. So the heroine of that book, I've described her in a particular way, you know, this is how she looks, and this is how she is, and you know, this is her hair, and this is her figure, and this is, I mean, the whole personality, and the physical aspect of it, just to give the reader a feel of, you know, the physical dimension as I was explaining yesterday. And so I said, you know, curly hair and this type of eyes, and so next time when I went to Delhi on leave, so my sister-in-law looked at me and she said, okay, curly hair, you know, this is the kind of, and my wife does not have curly hair, so, acha, aapko is tarah ki ladkiyan pasand hai. So, hota kya hai ki, when you write a story, lot of people will think that this is the story of your life, or this is what you like, and this is what you don't like, which is not the case, but you should not worry about it, because the real readers and the real lovers of art, which will comprise about 99.9% of your readership, are very unbiased in their, they're not very judgmental. It is only people around you who will have to read the book or your story because they're connected with you and they can't escape. So they will probably read and react in this way. So when, if you're thick skinned, so I told my sister-in-law, I said, haan, isi type ki ladkiyan mere ko pasand hai. So when I wrote the next book, now the another character, now wo dusre type ki ladki. So then she did not ask, probably got the message. So anyway, I've got excellent, this is not to say that I've got a very lovely sister-in-law and fantastic wife and everything's great. But I'm just saying that you need to be thick-skinned because people will relate your stories to you. And once you come about this, then you will be more natural and you will not be worried how are people going to react. And you should not. You should not. You should just be true to your craft. And as I was saying yesterday, it's short story writing or any kind of writing is craft. And craft does not come to you easily. Talent to maine pehle hi bata diya. Each one of you is extremely, extremely, extremely talented. It is just that you need to convince yourself to do that act and it will happen.
Yes, please.
I cannot be loud enough for you to... I just want to ask, like, I do write. Am I, like...
Hello. Yes. I do write, but I don't write stories at all. Like, I'll be writing some kind of, you know, there'll be passionate words that come into me after I see something, but that's not a story. Like, it may be, like, I don't know if it can be called an essay or something. Like, if I supposedly happen to see somebody who's fighting over children when they are in a park. You see, these days parents have become really intolerant. So they quickly jump into their situation and they will maybe end up having a fight among themselves. So that those kind of situations do move me a lot and I write, but they're not stories. So how do we make them stories? They're not stories. Okay. I will write, what I have written is, I'll say, okay, we should not do this. So it will be good to read, but it is not the story. Mm-hmm. So how to move from this to make a story out of it?
Is it just a story? Is it just a fictional or story? Isn't just something which is there in your mind or you imagine or you, I mean, create a imaginary thing and you, something that your mother may have said and which has been very inspirational or funny or thrilling, even spook, all those things are very much stories. I mean, in my site, most of the people, there's a group, during Independence Day we did a special series where the Fauji was writing stories. And so the Fauji was writing about war, And then they were also writing about their experiences. Matlab, one of them wrote about a ghostly experience that he had, which was funny. But then it's a part of his life. When you say that you saw children playing in a park and that is an essay, probably that is Kulpreet's genre. Open Road Review would love to hear from you. When you actually turn that, when you say that mothers are intolerant, when you see a mother reacting to something that a child has done, that is a story. That is where I will be there for you.
I need to learn to differentiate.
I
not a story. I have not written that. That would be
an article, but that's not a story. And I have been writing since I was in school, and things, situations, they say, Hindi maybe I used to write, English also, but not stories. They are not stories.
See, let me just. Very, very good question. Very good question. We sometimes have very profound thoughts which are not stories, and we jot it down and we think they're very great, but we don't know what to do with them because people accept only stories, and these are just thoughts. So there's one guy called Hugh Pather or Penther, I don't remember. He wrote a book called Notes to Myself. So he was a guy working in mines somewhere in the United States in 80s or 70s, I don't really remember. My brother gifted that book to me and I thought, what is this, Notes to Myself? And then I read this, I was fascinated. And in the preface, the publisher had written a preface in which he explained that I get a, you know, subscription, the manuscript from one guy from some remote corner who's never written anything. And it's all slices of life, teen char char page ke, do teen line ke, everything is scattered. Notes to Myself. So there was a guy for 10 years, whatever he was experiencing and whatever he was learning, he was writing that, and the heading was Notes to Myself. And Notes to Myself, you can go and look up, is a best-selling novel of 80s and 90s and 70s, you know. It sold really well. Even now it is there in my library and it is very profound. So there is always a scope of experimentation. See, it is just that even when you go to a bookstore, it is just the publishers and the whole mechanics of commercial publishing which has put books in certain categories, you know. Ye romance hai, ye thriller hai, ye horror hai, ye short story hai. So that is just for the ease of distribution, shelf placing, and you know, you need to compartmentalize thing. But art you cannot put in compartments. So if you have something which you think is really unique, I think they will be takers. This is what experimental writing is all about. Nowadays there are books available which have poetry and prose together. Right? So if you want to experiment, yes, when you experiment and you send this kind of work, there may not be that much of reception because people are used to ideas. But Notes to Myself, this publisher says, the publisher was not doing too well. And he said, I keep getting so many manuscripts. But when I read this manuscript one evening, I immediately said that this book will be read by a lot of people. I'm going to bring it out and it is going to be a huge bestseller, and that's exactly what happened. So don't, if you feel that it can't be pushed beyond a certain point, don't push yourself. Just collect them over a period of time. Maybe you can have a blog and put them periodically, about 10% of your stuff, and see how people react, because blog is a powerful space. A lot of people comment from there, and then probably with all that feedback, you can improvise a blog, whatever, or you can send it to a publisher and say, this is experimental prose. I have a blog which has got a million followers or 50,000, 20,000 followers, and I feel that I'm just trying to think aloud here. All I'm trying to make a point is that if you feel that you have something good, unique, and all of us have that capacity, you must go ahead and do it.
I'd also like to share a poem which I've been
challenged as a youngster. Like, we were playing, and like one of a younger, you know, girl said that you can't write a poem. We were just having a chat, we were playing. So she said to my younger sister that your Didi cannot write a poem. So at that time I wrote a poem, that was my first poem, and that was Pradushan. I wrote in Hindi. But today, like, since he goes to school, and children, and they are my, you know, the area of passion maybe, like I read a lot around children. Not poems exactly, but I'll share a poem that I have written for schools. Shall I just read it?
Please.
A Wish. It's titled A Wish, and it says, may the schools become temples of learning, inducing optimism in every learner, raising exuberant global children, young adults who are full of life, with a twinkle still in their eyes, ready to take challenges in their stride, succeeding in any field of their choice. May the teachers, alongside parents, be the enablers in this journey.
May every child get enough of sun, soil and water to open from bud to full blossom. May we all be partners in shaping the future that's peaceful, loving and encouraging, not for one, but for all. Let the world be their playground, where they jump and hop around. May the schools become temples of learning.
Excellent. So here, madam, in your situation, someone said you can't write a poem, and he wrote such a beautiful poem. So I've got a final request before Koral concludes this session, and that is, I don't think any one of you can buy my book from down. Did you get it?
Yeah.
Okay. Koral, please conclude the session, please. After that, I'll thank the partners.
So, do any of you have any question, any clarification, anything to still say? Yes.
Yesterday night I had written a poem, and you had just asked us that had we written something that we had not shared. If I have your permission, may I share it with the group?
Yes, first you read it out, then I'll answer your question.
Okay. It's an untitled poem. I'll go a little fast because I know we're running out of time. It goes like this. In search of greener pastures, she flew. In hope of solace, she built herself anew. A foreign land and many new faces. Some smiled genuine, some painfully stitched. She's learned the art of faking a smile, of putting up with while, even though it kills her inside. The value of relationships was difficult to learn. She has lost some, but gained a lot in return.
Thank you so much. It's beautiful. Let me hear it from us. Answering your question, here I have a gentleman. I am taking the seat and getting all the eyeballs towards me, and he's sitting in that corner recording you guys. He's my co-founder for Tell Me Your Story. His name is Aditya Kajalekar. What we plan to do is the little bit of portions that we have recorded right now, which include Kulpreet, you are not copyrighted right now, you are our copyright. So we have taken down all those, which will go up on portion by portion on our YouTube as video stories or video poems. You are more than welcome to write and send it to us as well. Nevertheless, we will have it on our YouTube channel once we go back. We will in fact launch our YouTube channel with these small little contributions that we have got. So much thanks, lots of gratitude to each and every one of you who participated, who spoke to us, and who's there in this room to hear it out from us. Now. Further from this, before as I conclude, my request to everybody is the small stories that you write, the poems that you write, even if you are fond of writing plays, please do write, send it to us. As I said right in the beginning, that we usually don't reject. What we might do is mentor and help you transform it into something different, something better. And we would love to hear from you. Once you visit our website, do send us your feedback. If you feel that something is not working out, please do report it. We have just started this website in July, and if in September we are here in one of the international lit fests, we have reasons to believe that we have done a little bit of contribution. We are going right. But we will need your support. We will need your feedback. Please do write to us. Write your stories. Write your poems. As I said, every new author is our achievement. So thank you so much. All of you.